Carol and I are very close friends for many years, and this is actually our fourth event together. which
I then why am I here?
So, and I'm not going to embarrass you too much praising you in the third person, but I have to say that Carol is truly an inspiration. She is an incredible mentor to so many people, and the fact that she was a mentor to me is not an original statement, but very heartfelt. And not only did she has she been a mentor to a lot of assistants and aspiring editors, but also she's fought really hard for the rights of editors and did some very historical things when she was head of the union, president of the union and vice president. I mean, there was a point where the union was really awful. I mean, it was so ossified, and basically you couldn't get in the union unless you knew someone. It was nepotism. And there was also this whole seniority system, mm-hmm. where there were different groups, and if you had the most seniority, you were in group one, and if not everybody in group one was working, then people in group two couldn't get a job. So it was sort of protecting the weak and punishing the talented and young aspiring people. And when Carol was president of the union, the reason why she became president was because of that. And she, during the period that she was doing that, the union opened up in an extraordinary way. And also, when you were vice president, there was also the East and West Coast
were united. To a national union. Before, people from New York couldn't work in L.A., people in L.A. couldn't work in New York. And there were some provisions where you could hire a standby editor. When I worked in New York, I'd hire a standby New York editor, and it's like feather bedding. So we changed that.
Yeah, and she's a very brave person. I mean, she got calls at night where you'll never work in the business again kind of thing. You know, she was threatening to a lot of, you know, older guys. And it was very brave. So I'm very proud of you that you did that.
Thank you, Bobbie.
So I had to say that right off the bat because it's a huge thing. I just want to briefly tell you my history with Carol because it may have some meaning for you as well. The reason why I met Carol was that a mutual friend, Susanna Parrish, who's a music editor, said to me that you have to meet her because she reminds me so much of Sam, my late husband, who was a wonderful editor. And the reasons were dignity about his profession, or dignity about their profession, love for what they do, wonderful sense of humor, wonderful storytellers, great sense of rhythm, and my favorite is that you both sing when you cut. So Carol does
I
have.
I talk to myself too. I don't know. Does Sam do that?
Yes.
Oh, you idiot.
So we did our first event together 7 years ago.
Really?
And Carol, on my second book, she was actually the only editor I interviewed for that book. So we've had, and that event was Body Heat. We screened Body Heat at the Billy Wilder Theater in L.A., and it was really wonderful. And but now I want to talk about another thing that happened is last year Carol received the Career Achievement Award for American Cinema Editors for the Eddies, and I was asked to write the tribute article, and it was really interesting because she had to write her list of accomplishments. And this is what Carol considers accomplishments. Obviously, she wrote her education and her film credits. And then peppered throughout, she had these entries, Camino del Santiago, Chemin Saint-Jacques. And these were restorative medieval walks, mm-hmm. in France and Spain. She considered those accomplishments equal to the film she worked on. And the reason why I'm mentioning that is I think one of the things we want to emphasize tonight, mm-hmm. is the importance of having a life. And it not only makes your work better, being a part of nature, or gardening, or going to museums, or But all of that makes you a better artist and makes you sane. And Carol has always been an advocate of...
Well, I don't know about the sanity, but...
Sanity is harder to achieve, but...
Yeah, but that's right, huh?
So, and just briefly to talk about who you are, where you came from, you started off on the Oklahoma prairie.
Yes.
And you had very... You were in the middle of nowhere basically, and you had to entertain yourself. You were kind of intrepid, strong person in your own way, quiet,
but little kid anyway.
Little kid, and then you were also a musician, and you were a student of literature in college, and you ended up getting a Fulbright scholarship and ended up in Paris, in Europe, where you met John. John Bailey, who is a master cinematographer. I think it's very unusual that master editor and cinematographer are married. And
A long time,
45 years, and you've known each other over 50
years? That's a military secret, yes. We have been married 45 years.
And in fact, they did 12 films together, and I did an event with them where we screened The Big Chill, which they did together, and we ran the opening montage, and then we ran the whole film. And afterwards, John said something interesting about you. He said, you know, this woman, she's very lovely, my wife, but she always gets what she wants. And I thought, I call Carol the Steel Magnolia. And she has this wonderful, she's very strong and has this wonderful ability to fight for what she believes in, but you're lovely at the same time. And I think that's a nice, it's an inspiring thing to cultivate in the business. It's hard to fight for what you want sometimes. And the other thing I wanted, and I'm going to stop talking about you and let you talk, but I also wanted to mention that it was interesting, you had some hurdles in your life. One of them was when you couldn't get into the union and you finally had your own commercial business.
Because it was non-union.
And can you explain what happened when you were offered your first job?
Oh, yes, I'll tell you this interesting story. Just a statistic, first of all. Everybody seems to think that there are lots and lots of women in post-production. But I was just curious about it because now the local, editing local, post-production local, has about 6,000 members. And when I joined, there were like 900. Of course, that was just LA. And at the time, there were about 17% women. So I was just curious, how many women are in our local now? It's like 19%, 20%. The numbers have not expanded that much, even though there are 6,000 people who are members. The statistics are pretty much the same. So I feel that every time I work on a job, I try to hire a woman assistant. Because if they don't get hired by me, who's going to hire them? You know, I mean, I'm a woman. I need to hire as many minorities as I possibly can, and I make a practice of doing that. But the story that you were referring to, I was working in my little company doing commercials, and I would take two or three spots every week to a place called Taddeo, which was a mixing studio, a very fine mixing studio. And one of their very best mixers would mix these for me. And his name was Buzz Knutson, very, very fine mixer. And I told him one day that I had been offered a job as to edit a film from one of the commercial directors that I had been working with, and that I was going to sell my company, and that was it. I didn't want to do it anymore. I was going to jump over into features. And he said, Carol, I'm going to give you some advice. The film business is cutthroat. You do not want to do this. It's not a place for women. And furthermore, if you are hired to do this, and I doubt that you'll be able to make it, he was painting a very, very black picture for me, you'll be taking work away from others, from men who have families and wives. And I said, wow, that's interesting to myself. I said, Buzz, I'm surprised that you're telling me this. And he said, well, I just have to tell you the truth. It's just simply not a good idea. You should stay where you are. You've got a great company. Everything's working out fine for you. And that just made me even more determined. I thought, I cannot believe that he actually said that and believed it. So there's always this backstory of sort of how men perceive women in the business. It has gotten a lot better, but back then, and that was a number of years ago, it was pretty grim. So I'm just giving you that backstory.
So all these little stories I'm telling are for these kinds of reasons that you need to hear these things. Another story is when you got the, what was it called, the Fellowship and Service Award? Was that the name of it? The union gave her this award.
Because of all the years that I had spent doing. If you are an officer in the union, it's a volunteer job. But it takes an awful lot of time. And I had been president and vice president. I was also an editor's representative on the board of the local in L.A., Local 700. And so they gave me the service award because I had been around for so long.
But honestly, the whole evening, the speeches that the assistants gave, that all the things that Carol did for them, it was pretty incredible. But then
it was very sweet.
The big laugh, you got a big laugh, because she told a story. I think you guys will all know, find this very familiar. Late at night.
You've been working and working late at night, and you've already been on the job for, say, 10 or 12 hours, and the producer decides, well, I'll get dinner for everyone. So they go get dinner, and they bring it in, and guess what it is? By the time you get around to it, what is it? Cold pizza. And I remember once I was working on this film, and it had a very pretty good sized budget. And we were not going to pull an all-nighter, but we had been there a long time. And the producer came in with pizza. We weren't able to eat it right away. And he said, well, why don't you just eat it while you're working at your bench? This is when we were working on film. And I turned to him and I said, you've got to be kidding. You've got to be kidding. First of all, you bring in pizza, which I do not consider to be a meal. And secondly, you offer to have us eat it. It's already cold in our cutting room. I said, goodbye. I just packed up my stuff and left. He never did that again. Never did it again. But really, seriously, you have to keep your health. It's very, very important. This work is very demanding, long hours. You're sitting and sitting and sitting, or standing and standing and standing. And after a while, your mind can just kind of get blunt, you know, from it. And your body starts to cave, and you start to, you know, you at the end of a job, you're so unhealthy, you get sick right away because you haven't given your body permission to have a recess. And when you do, it just kind of caves in on you. It's really, really important to stay healthy. Your mind works better when it does. And I sort of limit my hours. I know that anything past 10 hours, I'm no good. So I just stop. Come back in the next day, and I'm able to work a lot better. And I eat good meals. I don't have much for lunch because I don't want to get sleepy. But I usually have fruit or maybe a salad. And it makes sense. You know, you got to keep healthy.
But also just the idea of taking a walk or
Take a break. I take a break at lunch. I go out, walk around the block. Not here because it's icy, but
another story that I love is that just about embracing your feeling confident about your opinions and really being true to yourself is a big break for you in your career was when you met Lawrence Kasdan, they had a wonderful 30-year did eight films together. He's a brilliant writer, director. So you were being interviewed for Body Heat, your first film together, and he asked you what you thought of the script.
And actually, Body Heat, of course, is a genre film. It's a film noir. And I knew that Larry was interviewing several people, but I got a call from him, actually, asking if I would read the script, and maybe we'd get together and chat about it. So I read it and then went to his office. At the time was on the lot at Warner Brothers. And he said, so? What'd you think? I said, well, I just love film noir, and I thought it was wonderful. I love this sort of tough language, tough dames, and tough guys talking tough language. But I like most of all the sense of humor. So we talked about it a little bit, and he said, you know, I've had several editors read this, and you're the first person who said that you like the humor. in the script. So we talked a little bit more, and he said, okay, I'll call you back in a couple of days. I thought, well, I blew that one. He must not have thought it was as funny as I did. And sure enough, 2 days later, he called, and he said, okay, let's do it. So when you do have a meeting, I think it probably does pay to say exactly what you think about it. And we could talk about that, too, because we have sort of responsibilities when we're in pre-production and production and post-production, and we can kind of talk about all that.
Yeah, I mean, we might as well. I think one of the things you told me, I was actually telling Janice about this, I think it'd be really useful for these people to know when someone comes to interview for a job with you,
You mean to be an assistant or?
To be an assistant. What do you like and dislike about, I mean, what are
the qualities?
What are the qualities you're looking for?
Well, for me, I like somebody who can really be a critic of what we're doing in the cutting room. Somebody who has a fascination with story and who can be analytical about the story and can give a contribution to it, who's willing to work and work hard. And I like someone that can be a collaborator with me, to be the first audience. So when I show something, you know, that I've done to the assistant or assistants, I can say, well, so what do you think about it? And usually they just crucify me, which I like. They'll say, oh, well, why did you do that? And why did you do this? And why did you do that? But I like having that first round of critique, of criticism, coming for people who are inside the process, because they've more than likely have seen all the dailies, because you, as an assistant, you compile them and order them, so you've seen them, or you've put them in scripter, so you already know what the material is. So it's very valuable to have someone close to the process be the first level of critique.
And that's another example of trusting that your opinion matters, and not to be afraid to
step forward.
But what don't you like that people do in interviews?
What don't I like that people do in interviews? Oh, gee, what would that be?
You told me.
You better remind me. There are probably several things, but what is the worst?
Well, you said, I mean, this is not a total criticism. I mean, I understand that if you want a job, you want to sell yourself.
Sure.
But you have to temper that and not just talk about yourself.
I see. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I've had interviews where people have come in and I will sit for 30 minutes while they rap on about themselves. You know, it's like, okay. That's very interesting.
And it's maybe something you wouldn't necessarily think about because you're excited, but it's a good thing to just catch yourself.
I think how intimate it is being in a cutting room, and you want to be able to know that you can get along with that person. So a certain amount of dialogue and exchange is absolutely essential. So I would like for someone to sort of relax and chit-chat a little bit about your life and where you're from and what your interests are outside of editing, and just see how well-rounded you are, you know, that kind of thing. And it just makes sense. Ultimately, we'll be friends, and I have to say that a lot of the assistants that I've worked with, I've become so fond of them that I would bring them on as my co-editor, you know, and then that sort of gives them the leg up to go on with their career. And I enjoy doing that. So I want to be friends with the people that I'm working with. The main thing.
Yeah. Going back for a moment to the Lawrence Kasdan interview, the other thing that was interesting, this was one of the maybe rarer times when being a woman was to your advantage in terms of your perspective. Do you want to talk about
that? Because he had asked me what I thought about the sexual innuendo in the script. And I said, well, I like specifically that. I hope it's not going to be too explicit, because I think sexual material, is especially in film noir, is much stronger if it's suggestive. What's implied is far more interesting to me and much more erotic than being explicit. And he said, yeah, it was my thoughts exactly. So he was actually very happy that we were, as the saying goes, on the same page about that. And it would be very interesting for me to show you someday the outtakes because they're pretty steamy.
He did get the panty shot in, though.
Yes, he did.
You didn't want the panty
like
shot. How many of you have seen Body Heat? Yeah, you should see it. It's really...
I hadn't seen it in quite a while and looked at it not too long ago and thought, wow, actually with Columbia students, because I've been here for a couple of weeks critiquing their films. So I showed Body Heat and I said, well, I hadn't seen that since we looked at it together. So that really holds up pretty well. It's pretty good.
Yeah, because it's mm-hmm. it's, you know, it's like double indemnity kind
mm-hmm.
of, but it's much more modern. It's much more complex and mm-hmm. he's the bimbo,
which
is kind of interesting.
Bill Hurt is the blonde bimbo. not Kathleen Turner. Kathleen Turner turns out to be extremely smart.
Really smart.
And very manipulative, and yeah.
But it's interesting what you were saying about it is a bit of a send-up, so the mm-hmm. humor, it's subtle, but...
Yeah, but it is.
But it is there, yeah.
And Larry also said that he wanted a woman editor for that very reason, that he felt there would be some level of censorship in the sexual material just by virtue of being a woman, that the story is told from Bill Hurt's point of view, but Maddie Walker, who is manipulating him at every step, is three steps ahead of him at all times, that there would be some sensibility about that. And I don't know if he was right or wrong, but that was his thought.
No, I mean, I think it's true. So the other thing I want to mention is using everything in your arsenal to contribute to your art. And in your case, you were a musician. Or mm-hmm. are you still a musician?
No, I haven't played in a long time.
She played the oboe.
Uh-huh.
But what was funny was when you first start, before you became a film editor, mm-hmm. you said, I'm not sure I want to be a musician because I'll spend so much time in dark rehearsal rooms.
That's right.
And look what happened.
But I would have to say that, music, quite apart from the musicality of editing, the discipline of learning an instrument, of practicing until it's perfect, of refining it, of getting it to sound right, all the things that you have to do to master an instrument, that same discipline, you just take those skills and move it over here in the editing room, it's the same thing. It's absolutely the same thing.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. interesting, but it's also, there is something, if you really watch a lot of Carol's films, there is a musicality to her, your work.
Well, thank you.
No, there is, and there's, in the book we deconstructed the opening of The Big Chill, and I said, one of the things I noticed about that is that there's, well, you call it a California stop. Do you know what a California stop is? You don't come to a complete.
You still go to cruise through the stop sign.
Yeah. So that there's this constant sort of subtle, like nothing ever, she gets it at that perfect moment where there's just this little bit of motion and then you're on to the next cut and mm-hmm. there's this fluidity in the movement and we tried to talk about how music works with visuals. Mm-hmm. It's a very, it's tough to talk about editing, period, because it's so instinctual, but there definitely is a sensibility that Carol has about music that, from being a musician, that I think is particularly heightened as an
Well, if you think about music, especially concert music, it is totally interpretive, and there are markings on the music sheet itself that tell you when to stop, when to take a breath, when to when a phrase ends, when you start another phrase. But after a while, you just feel it. You know when it's right. You know how long the pause should be. You know how long a beat can be extenuated or it can be shortened, and the tempo, you just get a feeling for it. And I think editing in many respects is exactly the same thing. And what we do is analytical. It truly is analytical, but even more than that, it's emotional. If you don't move someone in a film, either to laughter or to tears or to any emotion or combination of emotions, it's what you're working on is simply not going to be successful. People like movies because they are moved to laughter, to tears. The other thing is that if you bore an audience, it also will be a failure. That's our biggest enemy, and I think Sam said that.
Boredom is the enemy.
Yeah, boredom is the enemy. So you want, on one hand, you want to entertain on so many different levels. And I don't mean entertain comedically. I mean, you want to engage an audience. Well, you engage an audience primarily by surprise, suspense, laughter, tears, all kinds of emotions. So it's that's what you're dealing with. And music has all of that. And if we communicate in music, we're not communicating in words. And so much of editing is nonverbal. Now, I've been working with a lot of students at Columbia this year, and it's amazing how many films are full of dialogue, absolutely brimming with dialogue, when the story itself would be much, much stronger if it were reduced by half. Dialogue kills films, and Americans, for some reason, American film, they just chatter, 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 talk, 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 talk. If the actor isn't talking, they assume nothing's happening, you know, especially producers.
But also part and parcel of that is also the whole need to have too much
exposition.
Exposition, yeah. And not let the audience discover and trust their mm-hmm. intelligence and their insights.
Exactly.
And let them find it. And that's talking is part of.
Mm-hmm.
But speaking of language, I mean, also I think the musicality of language is, I mean, there's a...
Yes, there's a musicality in language as well. Absolutely.
A certain rhythm.
You know, you can see a film that's in Japanese or one that's in French or one that's in German or any language. And after a while, you pick up on the rhythm of that language and you don't understand any of it. But there is meaning inside the intonation, inside of the basic rhythms of that language. And we are very attuned to that in English. We just don't think about it very much. But when you start editing, you start thinking about all of those qualities.
What would you mm-hmm. say, so this, what Carol's talking about, it's a master's program at Columbia, and she's you're the editor in residence, and mm-hmm. you're basically mm-hmm. looking at their films and helping them mm-hmm. do their
just
final
critique it and,
critique
and
it.
To give some suggestions and options and you know.
So what else would you say are the things that they the biggest sort of mistakes that they made that the insights that you gave them from that class?
I wouldn't call them mistakes necessarily, but I think that there are several things that most of these projects have been directed and are directed and or written by the same person, written and directed by, and many times even edited by. So everybody's wearing two or three, or maybe, you know, doing a lot of things at once on these films. And I think it's very instructive for them to realize that the more that you can pare a story down and distill it and distill it and distill it, the more powerful it is. I'm not talking about speed. I'm talking about distillation. And a lot of times people, when you talk about organizing the material so that it's very solid and it's very firm and it has a lot of different layers, they automatically think, oh, that means making it faster. And I would have to say that almost all of the films, with the exception of Ellie's, were too short. They were too fast. They're just like dialogues lickety-split. And you don't have a chance to even feel what's happening. They're, you know, fast can be good, fast can be bad, but if you don't have a sense of storytelling from one moment to the next, to the next, to the next, it just becomes a machine gun of information. Most of them are overwritten as well. Overwritten with way too much dialogue, way too much exposition, in the hopes that everything is clear. Well, clarity can be achieved without tons of exposition.
I love that you kept mm-hmm. calling editors the bad news bears.
Yes.
Well, they
well, we are the bad news
but
bears.
But it was also interesting that Carol mm-hmm. said these directors or aspiring director writers, mm-hmm. whatever, mm-hmm. various not aspiring editors, had virtually no idea what an editor contributes, which is, you know,
kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. If I could
back up a little bit, it might be interesting for you, and let me know because I can go off on any tangent here. sort of how I prepare my work, how
yeah,
I start.
I want to go Can you start with the screenplay?
I'll start with the screenplay. Yeah. I'll go through really quickly to kind of the way that I approach my work. Let's say that Larry, who's now a very good friend, gives me a script to read, and I'll read it, and then we chat about the script before it goes into production. I think the sooner that an editor can be involved in the process, the better. Unfortunately, these days, many times, a project will be shot, and then they say, oh, I guess we need an editor. We have to do this, we have to get this thing done in 3 months or 2 months or whatever. I guess we should hire an editor. So you get the material and you're starting over from, you know, you're starting at zero. Nobody's looked at it, nobody's organized it, nobody's done anything. Wouldn't it be lovely if you had a conversation with the other filmmakers before the project even was shot? Wouldn't it make sense for the editor to read the script and to comment on that? I mean, a lot of the things that I know work in a film don't even, you know, that's what you want to shoot. And many times there's so much more in a script that I know just reading it, it'll never be in the movie. So wouldn't it be nice for someone to have that conversation before it's shot? I kind of think so. So if you can put yourself in the position of having a relationship with a director so that you're able to read the script in advance, it also fortifies what you need to know about the director's take on the material. What is his emotional attitude towards the material? What is his stylistic attitude towards the material? How does he want the emotion to be? What kind of actors does he have in mind? I mean, all these things will inform your work in ways that will save so much time, and you will be on the same wavelength from the very beginning. So I think it's very, very important, if at all possible, to read the script before it is finished, even in rewrite stage.
But I also like that you talk about you make notations in the script because later on you will not be fresh anymore, and you have this.
I have some reference.
Yeah.
So when I'm reading the script for the first time, I actually am, you know, I'm not much of a digital person, so I kind of like the script on a page, on a piece of print. So I'll read it, and as I go through, I make a little check just in the margin of where I have a reaction. And just a little check. And things that sort of occurred to me that I particularly like about it. And I'll write those, I'll make a little check, then I'll go back through and elaborate the things that really occurred to me. Like, this is the heightened emotion between this character and that character happens here. I felt an overwhelming sense of anxiety here. I felt an overwhelming sense of peace or rest in this place. Just the bare emotions, because that's what we're really dealing with. I also will go through the script and make notations of particular sounds that are unusual, or if music is suggested in the script, I make a notation of that, so that I have kind of a point of view myself that represents, after all, editors are interpreters, that represents what I feel is the interpretation of the director or of the writer in the script. And I keep those things in this, literally write them out in the script. So several months from now, when we start to preview the film and we've looked at it so many times it starts to really feel stale, I will read the script again at that point. And I'm then reminded of my first impression. And if the first impression, which is the strongest impression in the script, is not evident in what I cut or what we cut together, there's a problem. So I need to make an adjustment. And that's how I stay fresh with the material. I kind of rely on my own sense memory of when I read it the first time. And since I can't remember anything, I'm getting old and gray, I have to write it out. But I've been doing this a long time, so that's no excuse. And then another thing that I do to prepare is that this collection of stuff that I have, backgrounds, sound effects, music ideas, I get all of those things and I load them into the Avid so that I have my own running little library of things that I know that I'm going to use over the course of just my edit. I work usually from the time that they start shooting. sometimes I work through rehearsal, and sometimes I work as early as revisions of the script. If you can, go to the rehearsals of the show, even if you say nothing and you're a fly speck on the wall, that will inform you so much about the qualities that the director wants in the emotion of the film. If you're able to do that, that's an incredible shortcut for the emotional context of the film that you're going to be working on and interpreting for the director. So if even if it's just a table read, it's very, very important. Now, one of the things that I feel is missing and is just such a shame that we no longer have communal dailies. Since we're work digitally, everybody gets their own dailies, and you look at them at home, on your iPad, on your iPhone, God, I don't even know. But on this last project that I worked on, everybody wanted to be included on the daily list. So we had to submit that to HBO so everyone would be authorized to look at dailies. You know what? I could go on and see who was logging on to look at dailies. I'll guarantee you I was the only person looking at dailies. The cinematographer would go on, and this was a very, very quick schedule, and admittedly, that was part of the problem. The cinematographer would go on and look at maybe one take of each setup, I'm sure just to be checking his lighting and compositions and see if they were all okay. The AD would go on once in a while, obviously he was checking something. The producers would go on and maybe look at one setup, and then that kind of tapered off. So they were looking at wardrobe and hair, primarily. They were just looking at what was being established. So I was the only person who was literally looking at everything. Then I find out that a lot of editors don't even look at everything. They just assume the last take is good, and that's what they use. I don't know what kind of editor that is. I mean, you really need to look at everything, because the moments that are rare, that these little nuggets, as Jonathan Demme would say, these nuggets that are embedded in the dailies that maybe the actor only did once, those things are priceless. And you want to work those into a scene because that's going to make it distinctive and unusual and arresting. So you must examine the dailies. Now, when we were on film, and I'm talking like an old film editor, which I am, we would look at dailies together. That means the director, the cinematographer, the gaffer, the costumer, the production designer, everybody would look at dailies together, and we had an ongoing critique of each person's work. If I had a problem, I could pull the director aside, being the bad news bear, and say, you really need to watch that performance because the person is only saying the lines, there's no acting between the lines. And you see that a lot in young actors. They're so nervous that they only act, they're not listening, they only act when they say the lines.
But you're also seeing mm-hmm. what's important it's to them, important. Like I really want uh-huh. this
exactly.
to start with this shot mm-hmm. because of blah blah or uh-huh. whatever.
And yeah. the director will give you notes if you're looking at them together. Now, I don't get any notes. Nobody has time at all. Another thing in digital filmmaking that just drives me mad is that you'll be shooting along, and the director will say, okay, just take it from the first position. So everybody rolls back, the prop people are in there, and you're stirring around, and okay, so let's go down. And there are multiple starts on a take. Well, nobody ever has a chance to change anything or refine anything because they're constantly just trying to figure out where they are. What did I have the glass in this hand or that hand? The glass was full, it's not full. You know, matching goes out the window. Actors lose their thread of thought. There's no correction from the director. It's just a terrible, terrible, terrible habit to get into. And I understand why, because they feel that if a scene is on its feet all the time and you never cut, number one, it's quicker, and number two, there's no break in concentration. But on the contrary, that's precisely what you're doing. I would much rather, I see this on the set, I would much rather have a director next to the camera than in Video Village screaming out and saying, do it over again, start with blah, blah, blah. What kind of direction is that? You want to be right next to the camera and talk to the actor in between takes, give them notes, correct it, and then do the next take.
And then you have this expression, hosing it down.
Yeah, right. And I call this digital filmmaking these days. They never turn the camera off because it can just go forever. So everything is shot like this. Everybody's getting wet. Everybody gets their chance to be.
But the editor will fix it.
Yeah. So you know what happens? Then the editor is directing the movie in the cutting room. And that is not what an editor should be.
You can't fix it.
And a lot of times, if a film isn't directed well, there's not a thing you can do with it. I mean, you can hack it up, and you can move things around, and just be as creative as you can. But you know, we all go into a project hoping 300% that it's going to be the best thing, the most extraordinary thing. And at each stage, you know, if you can stay at 90%, that's pretty good. If you can stay at 60%, that's okay. But anything below that is like, oh, disaster. So I think really that there's a certain amount of preparation that an editor can do in pre-production. There's an awful lot that we can do in production. If we are involved in production, let's hope so. And your chances of being able to mold the material in a creative way, if you start after everything is shot, is already compromised. It's already compromised.
Can you also talk about how you approach a scene? Okay, you're mm-hmm. about to start.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Do you want me to talk about that?
Yeah.
How I approach a scene? Okay, great. You know, what I like to do is take all the data. Now, the assistants have already organized everything for me. And I like to use a scripter because you can just kind of get back to it right away. Right in the script where everything occurs. You've always used scripter, haven't you, on an Avid? No. No, it's a program that has interest the script, and it's like the line script that you get that's on paper, except that it's in the Avid, so that you can access it right off the script that's in the Avid. I don't know how to explain it otherwise. Yeah, you just click on the little dots and it links to that. And there, let's say you have five different setups in a scene. They're all lined up on the scripter. There's a little, tiny little reference, film reference at the top, so you know what it looks like. And you can just tap into that shot on each line. There are like five shots that cover that line. So you can just tap on it. But what I like to do is I look at all the dailies and I write notes when I'm watching dailies. They've been organized for me in script order. So let's say we're looking at scene 30, and scene 30 has, just to make it easy, five setups. I look at all of them and I write notes about, then I think about it for a minute and I kind of make a little sketch in my mind. I sort of pre-visualization, if there's such a word, in my head. And I write out what, because if the director's directing a scene well, I have an indication of what he or she intended for the first shot and the last shot. So I just say to myself, okay, that's the first shot. Here's the last shot. And the architecture of the scene kind of has a spatial thing in my head. And I realize that we'll go from here to here to here to here to here and eventually get to the last shot. So I have a pretty good notion of how I feel the scene would unfold. And I just sort of can see it in my head. And I then, in my notes, I know that there was something very interesting on this line, this such and such actor made, on this one and this one and this one. So I will take quite a while studying the dailies. Usually on this last film, I would look at dailies coming in like at 8 in the morning. I would look at them till about 1 o'clock, break for lunch, clear my head, and then after lunch, I'd start cutting. And usually the assistants would say, what are you working on? I said, I'm still looking at dailies. He said, what? I'm still looking at dailies. I said, oh, okay. But I can put the scene together pretty fast because I've done all the work, all the thinking. That's something that is a holdover for me from cutting on film, because it was so difficult to manipulate the film when it was actual film. You really thought about it and you could visualize it in your head before you started to cut. So I have that same habit. I also have the same habit of remembering footage once I've seen it. And that comes from film also. You had to have these habits because you couldn't spend all your time hunting for things on film. You had to know where it was.
Every splice mm-hmm. show, too.
Yeah, right,
so
every splice.
You thought twice about making a cut.
And you'd know whether you'd been through that territory before. Oh, I used that take because I had a splice on it or a grease pencil mark on it. Anyway, so that's kind of how I start my day, looking at dailies really well. When I put the scene together, I don't refine it. I just put it together so it flows. The performances are there. I put it aside. The next day, I start with a new scene. I look at everything. I put that in a cut, put that aside, then pick up the scene that I was working the day before because my head is cleared on it. I look at it and make a few changes if it needs to be. Or I gather up three or four scenes that belong to a sequence, not refining, just putting them together. Then when all of those sequences are shot, then I put all of those together, then I start refining. I find that young film editors refine too much until they get the material around it. Because the what happens before informs what's coming next.
It's dominoes.
Yeah, it's dominoes. And if you don't think about cutting a sequence and you're sitting there refining and refining and refining a moment that may never be in the movie, you're sort of losing the flow of the film with these tiny little corrections, tiny little things, this little frame, that little frame, this little thing, that little eye, this little thing. You're just getting completely
like
sidetracked.
A rabbit hole.
Yeah, you're sidetracked by minutia. So you want to get the big picture first and then start to hone it down. So I'm always putting something aside and coming back to it.
You know, what's another interesting mm-hmm. thing about sort of your discipline or mm-hmm. your way of working, and I know you've talked about this and other editors have too, is when you're really obsessing and you're trying to solve something and you're just kind of going crazy
yeah.
and just, you have to walk away from it.
Yeah.
You have to let the sores mm-hmm. heal.
Exactly.
And it's hard sometimes because you want to win.
You want to attack it and attack it and attack it.
But it's so bad. It's true mm-hmm. of writing too. It's true of anything really, but to just mm-hmm. go home or do
or
something
or take
else
a walk.
Or
take
do
a walk.
Something else. And
I usually take a break in the middle of the day and just take a walk just to clear my head and to rest my eyes. Because if you're looking at a computer all the time, you're going to wear yourself out. You know, now I've ruined my eyesight. I have to wear these incredible magnifying glasses to be able to see what I'm doing on the screen. So I'd show them to you, they scare you. But yes, I do put it aside because a lot of the problems that you'll have just in joining two pieces of film, put it aside because the problems in actually making a join will disappear because many times it's not that important, or you'll just see a solution to your problem. Your mind kind of sees the solution much quicker when you're fresh and take a fresh approach to the material than if you're just constantly sitting there trying to solve it.
You lose your objectivity, which is one of the most important tools an editor has.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We're the first audience, you know.
Yeah.
We are the first audience. So this refining thing, yes, it has its place, but it depends when you do it. Another thing that I've noticed, especially with the Columbia students that I've just been working with, they want to perfect everything before they show it. They want to have complete complement of effects, of backgrounds, music, on and on and on. I don't care about all that. I just want to see how the scene is playing. I just want to see how it's playing with the sparest of elements.
That's not going to make it work.
No, it's not going to make it. What makes it work are just a couple of dialogue tracks, maybe a simple background track, and maybe one music track. And maybe not even the music track. Just simple, simple. Keep it simple, simple, simple. If you start overcomplicating all the details, you'll never build the spine. You know, we have a spine and we have all these appendages. The spine is really important. The core is really important. So you want to cut the core of the story, and then you can put all the embellishments on and have fun with it and experiment and all of that. But if you start experimenting with weird, crazy stuff, you're never going to have the satisfaction or the knowledge of how the scene works if it's just really simple. Simple's hard, folks. Doing something simply is really, really difficult. It's really difficult. That's why I love Ellie's film, because it's so stripped and it's so emotional, it's so immediate and so good. I wish I could show it to you. It's really terrific. But, you know, you have to trust the material to do that. You really do. So anyway, let's go on with sort of how I work. At some point, the director's going to see what you've done. And many times, the director really likes to have like a little preview at the end of the week, which I think is pretty helpful, because they can see where their film is going with the performances. Because believe me, our most important task is keeping a performance as good as it can possibly be. That's for every actor. You have to go in and really, really work hard on an actor's performance. Some actors will be brilliant in some ways and weak in others. And every actor has their way of being in front of the camera. And you want to be sure that you are honoring that and that you are assisting that actor in getting the very best performance on the screen. I mean, that's really our responsibility. That's it. So I work very, very hard in honing the performances. Now, what do you do if you have a real problem performance? And even among professionals, professional actors, that is, you will have a problem performer. I've had several where a performer just cannot, an actor just simply cannot remember their lines. They just can't remember their lines. But they're good at what they do. I mean, they have an emotional sense, an emotional life that exists separate from the dialogue, if you will. And other actors, it's in tandem with the dialogue. You just have to go in and see where their weaknesses are in front of the camera. Some actors are really good on the first and second take, and then they taper off. Other actors are really good. They work up to it. They finally get there incrementally on take 15, 20, 25. But you need to know where they're best and trust that. That's why you got to see all the dailies, because not every actor is uniform. And the needs of the script, of course, have to. This is the puzzle that's so much fun in editing. This is the part that's really, really delightful, is being able to take all these separate elements, put them together, and make it seem like it was always intended to be like that, and no other way. That's it. My God, that's fantastic. And remember, we were talking to Jerry Greenberg, and we had a credit arbitration on one of Jerry's films. I won't mention it because I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. But Jerry had gone in on a film and had taken it over from another editor, and there was a credit arbitration. The first editor felt that it needed to be a shared credit and he should have his name first, since he had done most of the work, or he thought he did. And it was a film that Jerry said, if you want me to do it, and he looked at it, he said, I have to start all over. So put all the dailies, this was back on film, put all the dailies back and I'll start over again, which he did. I saw, along with five or six other editors, both versions. And the editors, if you go into arbitration, the arbitration is final. If you go there and the editors say, well, it should be a shared credit or it should be only a single credit, that's why you're in arbitration. So we really felt that Jerry's version of the film, with the only variable was the editor. Same director, same producers, same footage, same everything. Jerry even had less time than the first editor. Night and day was the difference between what the first editor had done and what Jerry
Wouldn't that
had.
Be amazing to see, if and you could see both versions?
I was so naive up to that point. I thought, well, you look at the footage and there's just a way to do it. And everybody can see that. I saw it. So everybody can see it. No. That's what I realized. What an editor does when they lay their hands on a film is unique to that person. Absolutely unique to that person. They just have a way of working. That's why there's so many of us and why films look, you know, fresh and wonderful, or they just look horrible, depending upon who has their hands on it.
But you know what's interesting is that, so I've interviewed, I think, 45 editors,
wow.
Maybe. And what's starting to come out, and now I bring it up every time, I didn't at first, no matter how accomplished and brilliant and celebrated the editor is, every one of you has doubts.
Oh, yeah. Terrible doubts.
Terrible doubts, which is really good for you guys to hear. So it's sort of, this is kind of what the dialogue is. Mm-hmm. And it usually is when you're starting a new film. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm a fraud. I'm going to get found out.
Oh, yeah.
I've lost my touch. Mm-hmm. I don't know what I'm doing.
I don't know how to run the Abbott.
But this is amazing because there's everything externally has told them that they're really gifted, and yet it's I'm telling you this partly so don't feel badly if you feel that way.
No, it's always scary.
But also, yeah, it's scary.
It's
but
scary
it,
when
it's,
you start
it's
a film.
It's scary, and it's so hard. I mean, it's being an editor and facing the footage for the first time and just having a zillion, mathematically a zillion ways to go. Just endless. And
every place is a frame you can cut there.
And you're an artist. So if you're an artist, there's no black and white. What's right and what's wrong is.
Yeah.
And of course.
There's no right and wrong. It's just what seems right to you.
So you have to sort of find your sort of ballast and trust yourself. But I just think that, isn't that interesting that all editors feel that way.
I know I do. Every time I start a project, I think, oh, wow. First of all, they're all different. You know, as many times as I've been doing this, every time I do a project, I'm always surprised at, wow, I'm learning all over again.
Do you think there's anything specific besides the fact, do you think it's partly the nature of being sort of underappreciated and misunderstood?
Everybody's efforts reside in our cutting room. You know, everybody, meaning the writer, the director, the cinematographer, everybody's a director. You know, everybody's a director. So all that work resides with us.
And you're also
it's
the
a
end
huge
of the line.
Responsibility.
You're the end of
end of the line.
So this is it.
This is the last rewrite. This is the last rewrite. Believe me, rewriting.
And you're
going to
get blamed too. Well, sometimes.
That's true too.
That's true too. Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, you'll see this. You'll have screenings, and or you'll, you know, whether they're previews, you're having screenings for the director and all the producers. Now we don't have one producer. Now we have half a dozen. We've got a dozen, you know, two dozen. So they all come and they all feel like they need to say something. This is the truth. I'll tell you this. Everybody will tell you what the problem is, and because they see themselves as filmmakers, they'll tell you what the solution is. Don't trust that. Trust the problems. Yes, you want to be very aware of the problems of a film. Absolutely. And as people are viewing it, you want to know what those problems are, but they have not seen all the dailies. They have not been in the trenches with you and the director. So you want to just kind of disregard what they consider to be the solution, because chances are you don't even have that footage for the solution that they dream of. So you, of course, you can listen to them, but really what's important is that they're pointing out a problem. The solutions are for you to deal with. That's what you want to do. And a lot of times, directors will just get crazy. They'll say, well, what are we going to do, you know, with this and that? There's a problem scene, blah, 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 blah. And you just deconstruct what the problem is and say, well, maybe the problem isn't here. Maybe it is appearing before. You think about maybe it's two scenes before where the seeds of this scene are planted, but they're germinating in this scene three scenes down. So maybe the problem isn't really here. It's how it's set up. So you go back and check something else.
So that it's interesting. Sometimes you think, "What this is the problem?"
That's not
scene,
the problem at all.
But it's
that's
a setup.
It's
to
way
the
before
scene.
That. It's way before.
I mean,
that.
There's so many delicate and sort of subtle things that are involved in the director-editor relationship. Mm-hmm. I mean, you really are.
It's like a client-attorney relationship.
Or a husband and wife.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you have to pick your battles. You have to, you know, be sensitive to the fact that they're on the line.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. And also, I mean, the stories about directors who actually think they shot things that they didn't even shoot. Because
and that's because always a delicate situation
well,
as
because,
well.
But yeah, because they go in and they get only a percentage of what they really wanted, because that's the nature of filmmaking. Mm-hmm. And then it's kind of...
It's wishful thinking.
And then there's the first cut, which is, you know, vomit time. But it's just the nurturing role of being, you know, the sort of balance.
Yeah,
and Carol
is
amazing at that. But, you know, being this balance of being nurturing, but also being tough and saying, hey, I'm going to tell you the truth. And I have the objectivity.
It's sort of how you do that, you know.
Yeah, how you
yes,
play
you,
that.
We are the bad news bears. Absolutely. We're sitting one-on-one with a director, and is very, very forceful in what his or her point of view is, and you know that you want to be able to show them that, but deep down, you've already tried a lot of these things, and you know that the best possibility of getting the scene to work is doing it this way, not that way. So you have to be very diplomatic about it and say, well, great, let's work on that. We'll see where we go with that. And then I have a couple of options I'm thinking about, and we'll do those too. And they'll say, oh, that's great. You know, you don't have to say, I think it's got to be this way or else. You just are very diplomatic by saying, I think there's some options. You know, let's just explore this.
Yeah, being right doesn't get you
anywhere. No, being right does not get you anywhere.
That's true in a marriage too. I think it's a delicate balance, and I think there's the other part, which is we were just talking about killing your babies.
Yeah.
I mean, a director can do this most gorgeous scene or beautifully written scene, and it was so hard to shoot,
it cost so much, and. You know,
and it may...
It just may be a scene you don't need.
And you have to... And the editor has to...
Has to be able to say, let's look at it without that. Let's just look at the film once without this. And you look at it and you say, wow.
But there's also all these strategies about directors getting them to see what you see.
Mm-hmm.
Like you have a strong point of view and you can feel resistance.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're just not going for it.
Mm-hmm.
But you really think it's important, and like how you, okay, so you lay back for that moment because you can feel the resistance and just
you sort of are in the grass, you know, you're out there in the grass and you're creeping up, and suddenly you ambush them. No, you don't do it that way. No, no, that's a delicate situation. Yeah, but you know, your work. The main thing is that you are partners and you're working on this together. And there's give and take, and you, in the best of circumstances, you have great respect for the director, and the director has respect for you, and being in the cutting room is like being in a sanctuary, where you think you can try anything once just to see if it works. Even the wildest, craziest ideas, many times they seem to be off the wall, but they're really, hey. Wow.
Yeah, as an editor, that's a really important quality to be able to, even if you think it's completely ridiculous,
just do it.
Don't
once and take a look, you know.
Yeah.
You don't have to be resistant. Now, we all are working under the gun. We, you know, time is the commodity these days. So yes, it is difficult, and you'd like to just, as it were, cut to the chase. But many times you just have to work out the problems in the script and the problems in the overall feel of the film, or the tempo of the film, or the, you know, the unfolding of the film, and you just need to try a lot of things. Each one of these efforts informs what works, what really does work. So you just have to trust it. Trusting the editing process is the big, big thing that you want the director to feel with you. Trust the process. The process really does work. It really is good. This is where the movie is made. This is where we really hit pay dirt, is in the cutting room. So that's the frame of mind that you want to have when you're editing a movie. Not a defensive one, not one that panders, not one that analyzes the material sometimes. You just want to trust the process. I don't know what else
then
to say.
Then you always get what you want. That's what John said.
That's what he said.
I think the important things. Yeah. I mean, it is pick your battles. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are certain things I'm sure you
you feel really, really strongly about.
Yeah.
And others are not so strong.
Yeah.
Now, this is one thing that I really want to drive home to you guys as editors. Only because I saw a lot of this in the last couple of weeks with these student films, is that everybody seems to think, everybody that I talk to, that the dialogue can be handed off to the dialogue editor or what is now called the sound designer. That is not right. The editor, I want to tell you a big secret, the editor is in charge of the performances. And when there is an off-camera line that you need to hear on camera, I'm shooting you, then I'm shooting you, and when I'm intercutting it, when you're not talking, we're hearing her. But we have to hear her online dialogue, not what was recorded offline. You understand that? Really important. You want to take out the unmiked, off-mic dialogue and put the best dialogue that's on mic in. It gives you a tremendous opportunity to hone a performance. All those off-camera lines are terribly important that you get the right readings, the right speed, the right tempo. Those matter. You do not want the dialogue editor to be directing the movie. Those decisions are decisions that you need to make first, go over them with the director, and many times a line reading will be very, very important. You will have an image, let's say, that works perfectly, but it has a bad reading. You will get skilled in putting in a different reading into that person's mouth. Better than ADR, much, much, it's 20 times better than ADR if you can get a good production line to work on camera, replacing a line that you don't like, or replacing a line that has bad quality. So the whole dialogue track, all the dialogue track is your responsibility. That is your job. That is part of the performance. So you want to take all of that out. Another thing. If the dialogue works, if the film works in two ways, turn off the sound and look at the scene. If it works without the dialogue, you've hit pay dirt. If you turn the picture off and just listen to the dialogue, and it has emotion, and has flow, and has musicality, you've hit pay dirt. You want to look at scenes and be critical of scenes both ways. Just picture, just sound, and then put them together. With music, without music, with effects, without effects, with backgrounds, without backgrounds. You want to strip everything down. And if it works, like I said, you've hit pay dirt. That's crucial, crucial, crucial. The other thing is that in choosing picture shots, these days so many directors want to do everything in one big long shot where they're following an actor around. I look at one of those films and I know you're headed for trouble. So if I'm an editor on starting from the day they shoot, and I start seeing oners, which are beautiful, they can be absolutely beautiful, but there's no way out. There's no way out if you don't have something to cut to. So I will instill, even if it's just a reverse, like you're doing a walking shot on their faces, you would want to at least do a single and a single, you know, a tracking shot, or a reverse from behind. Something that you can cut to if you get into trouble. If you do one shot with nothing, that's what you've got. Then you're in the horrible situation of having to jump things or having to do all kinds of tricks like blow it up, just that. Another thing that I really don't like about digital editing, all those damn buttons. I really don't like all those buttons. I want to cut a scene first without touching anything. It's just trim mode, fast forward, fast reverse, and just clicking, muting, and or soloing a track. I don't want to blow anything up. I don't want to, what I mean by all the curlicues that you can put on shots, blowing them up, moving them in, out, slowing the speeds, all of these things, I want to just do it absolutely straight. Because I want to see what the problems are. I need to know what the problems are, because I need to get back to the director and say, this person is talking too fast. There's no place where I can put the scissors in between. The actors are acting, but there's no acting between the lines. You know what I mean about that? Someone's waiting and waiting and waiting. They're not listening. They're waiting and waiting and waiting. Then they say their line, but there's nothing in between. Action, reaction, action, reaction. What an actor does without dialogue is every bit as important as what they do with dialogue. So all of these problems, if you start reframing and doing this and doing that, all the things that we can do with an avid, which are just fabulous, you will never really know the power of the shot that's there in front of you. And a powerful shot that is conceived by the director and the cinematographer that really, really works in a scene is much more valuable than anything we could do to reframe it, reshoot it by using, you know, a slow zoom in, slow pull out. I mean, all kinds of things that you can do on the Avid. The integrity of a shot that's shot with an actual lens, that is the right proper lens for a shot, that's what you want. You want unadorned by an Avid or an editor using an Avid with all those damn buttons. Just look at it straight. Then when you show that to the director, it will inform them incredibly on what works and what doesn't work while they're shooting. But if you start dressing things up, they'll never really have a base level of a critique of the material. Furthermore, I know everybody likes Premiere and a lot of people still like Final Cut Pro, but I have to tell you that the trim mode and the review mode that's built into the Avid is your best friend. So that when you make a cut and you can look at it, just think of this. You're working with a movie all in two pieces of film. And the only way you know that it works, because you have to splice it over here, is to put it over in the moviola and run it. That's what trim mode is, except you don't have to move the film around. Mm-hmm. You can make the cut, you can look at it right then, you can actually, you know, you can extend how long your review, your loop is, and look at it, make sure that it looks good. But with Premiere and the way that a lot of people lasso shots, they put it all together and then they don't look at it. They don't see how it works. A cut only is valuable if it works in the sequence, not that you just slam something together. And you want to be able to learn how to overlap. You don't have to be on the person when they're talking. You can be off of them. And many times it's far more powerful that there's a reaction when someone's saying a line than when the person is saying the line. I mean, I know this sounds truly elementary, but this is what beginning editors forget. You don't have to cut to someone just because they're saying a line. You can cut to someone because their reaction's great.
Well, you're already getting that information.
Yeah, right. You're getting the information. You can hear it. So it's all about who says what, where are they, and for how long. That's what editing is. Who, when, how long. Who, when, how long. Leads me to another thing that's elementary, but it's really, really important. Whose scene is it? What is the point of view of the scene? Whose scene is it? We're fighting. And
really?
And you have the upper hand. You have the upper hand, and you win the argument. So the point of view could be mine as the vanquished. The point of view could be Bobby's as the winner. So you need to decide within the context of the film whose point of view it is. And that will inform you on the best way to cut the scene. Point of view, point of view, point of view, point of view, point of view. What can I say?
This stuff is gold, right?
I wish somebody would ask me some questions. Because
well, now we'll do. We're going to.
Oh, okay.
She has cut 37 films. By the way, the last film Carol was talking about is called All the Way, which she just got an Eddie for.
Okay.
Yay. It's really wonderful.
Thank you.
Brian Cranston plays LBJ. It's a very interesting film, HBO.
Especially in this political cycle that we're in. To see what it's like when Congress and a president actually can push legislation through and it works, like the Civil Rights Bill.
Well, everybody looks good now.
The Voting Rights Bill, the Civil Rights Bill, everybody looks good. And, you know, it works when you can have a loyal opposition, and you can work problems out, and the sense of compromise is best. Compromise is our best friend everywhere, even in making movies.
In the cutting room.
In the cutting room, yeah.
So let's open up to questions. Anything. You can ask about
one
films,
right
too.
Well, speaking of compromise, did you have any particular moments that you can think of where the director really wanted something in particular and you were like, just no?
I thought no.
Distinct moment where you...
There are little moments like that in almost every film, you know. There are little moments like that in every film.
Are you talking about big moments?
Yeah, like, you know, any
like a sequence.
Where you had to just go like, just no, we're not going to do that. We're just going to...
That's a very good question. I would say that there was a situation with Larry Kasdan where he's the writer of The Big Chill. Not only was he the writer, along with Barbara Benedict, was co-written, but it was about their years when they were in Michigan University. And this group of friends get together after one of their very best friends has committed suicide. So,
how many of you have seen Big Chill? Oh,
great. Oh, wow, lots of people.
Good.
So the story really is about Alex, whom you never really see. Mm-hmm. At the last scene in the film, or next to last scene, was a flashback of that group of friends in 1969 when they were students together at Michigan University, and there was like a 15-year period in between, like from 1982 or 3, 1969, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. So that flashback was really, really important for Larry. When I read the script the first time, I said, I'm not really sure that you need the flashback. And he said, he has a wonderful voice, it's kind of a foghorn voice, and he says, Carol, the reason for writing the script and all the themes are in that scene. It's like the seeds of who they were are in that scene. It's important. There's no way we could cut that out. So I said, okay, great. Very good. So it was shot. It was about an 8-minute sequence. It was two or three little scenes together. Showing each other, and it shows Alex, who is Kevin Costner. Mm-hmm. Now, there's like a 15-year difference between Kevin Costner and the rest of the cast, except for Meg Tilly. And when we did the flashback, the 60s, on top of the fact that I didn't feel we needed the scene, the 60s, so I was a student of the 60s, is like a costume party mm-hmm. with the long hair and the beads and the tie-dye and all that. You look at it and you say, what were we thinking of? But it looks like a costume party instead of like a real period. So when we cut back, not only did we have to contend with a flashback where the main person, Alex, is seen in flesh and blood, but he's also clearly at least 10 years younger. Mm-hmm. So the wigs and everything and the makeup, it just didn't work. So I said, well, Larry, what if we just lop this out and just took a look at it without the scene? He says, no, you don't get this, you don't get it. I said, well, I think it would really be better because I feel that all of us have had friends who never make it, you know. Either they've had an accident or they've taken their lives or whatever, and it's a horrible thing to come to terms with. So that's something that is universal for anyone who's lived any amount of time. So not seeing Alex made the film immediately far more universal. It was not fixed in time. Mm-hmm. That was my view. And when we looked at it, it was a little bit clunky at the end. We just slipped out the scene. He said, but there's no way to get to that last scene in the kitchen. I said, oh, I think there is. Why don't we try this? We worked at it together. And he still wasn't convinced. So we previewed one night with the flashback in and another night without. Mm-hmm. Clearly, the night without was the big success. So he said, yeah, it works better without. He said, but Larry, you're such a fine writer that all of the seeds of who they were revealed in the writing as the contemporary characters. Yeah. His own writing informed the script in such a way that he didn't really need that scene. Yeah. And he admitted it. He said, the seeds of who these people were are completely evident in the characterizations, because they were so well fleshed out, each
you
character.
Also, didn't you have to do some acrobatics in between, like you put little sections of it through?
Oh, yeah. We went through the whole thing. We thought we'd have the flashback in the beginning. We thought we would go to it at different times. We tried all kinds of ways to conserve this. Mm-hmm. I mean, we just worked it in everywhere, in every conceivable way. And it looked like just what it was. It looked like a piece of film that was shoved into a sequence. It didn't belong.
But you'll never, when I'm so frustrated, you'll never get to see. He never shows it on any
supplements. No, he won't, no.
It'd be so interesting just to see. You know?
Yeah, I don't even know if he has, he does have a copy of it. I know he does.
let's go get it.
and Larry doesn't like, special footage on DVDs and stuff. He says, no, the movie's that way. I don't want to tell. I want to show people the scenes we cut out. We cut them out.
Well, that is funny, though. A lot mm-hmm. of times, you look at those scenes, you say, "Oh, I know. I see why they cut them."
Yeah,
out.
I can see precisely why they cut that out.
Yeah.
No, but Larry is a terrific writer. I mean, just an extraordinary writer. And many times he doesn't trust his own writing. You know, you have to remind him, Larry, this was in here for a reason. You know, let's do it. Let's try. Let's really try to get it done. No, let's get rid of it.
So this is what he said about Carol. She's my teacher, my moral touchstone, my slave driver, my friend, my perfect companion.
Oh. When we're working on a film, he sees more me than he does his wife. And if Meg and I were not such good friends, I'm sure she'd be jealous.
Well, when he did the Lifetime Achievement, the Career Achievement
yeah, right.
Award, he said that you were his very best friend in the world or something. And
well,
I thought,
we are very
that
good friends.
Must be an awkward ride home.
We're very good friends, although I'm sure that Meg is his really best friend in the world.
I don't know. I'm not sure. but yeah, that's an interesting one mm-hmm. because he's also the writer.
Yeah. That's a tough one.
Yeah.
I love working with writer directors. And I just think it's because they're so pure about their story. And you're really, when you are working in the editing, you're working on the last rewrite. I just really enjoy working with directors who are writers.
But you don't think they get too possessive about their material?
Well, they can, but I think that's part of the fun.
Yeah.
Is being able to separate from that, you know.
Yeah.
When, you know, really have faith in what you've done, and when it works, you don't have to do it again and again and again. You just need to do it once, you know, that kind of thing. But I enjoy that. Yes, Ryan. There was another question.
I'm sorry. I'll let you call people.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just saw his hand.
I was wondering if you could tell us about one of your editing mentors as you were coming up in the craft, and then also how you kind of mentor some, maybe your mm-hmm. assistants or other editors that are coming mm-hmm. up.
Well, one of the problems with the union that Bobby was talking about is that when I was learning, I really didn't have a mentor because I couldn't get in the union. I couldn't work. When I got into the union, I couldn't work. So I literally, when the first union jobs that I did, I was the editor. Though I would roll back, when I first had entry-level jobs, a group of little entry-level jobs, one guy who was a very fine editor at 20th Century Fox had gotten completely burned out in his career. And he opened up a little post-production shop that had a sound department, so when we used to make sound transfers from quarter inch to 16 millimeter or 35 millimeter to cut with. And he had a sound library. And he had also a number of films, corporate films, little documentaries. Once in a while, there'd be a commercial that comes in. And he hired me to work there. And I got very little money because I didn't really know anything. And that's where I went to film school, was at Richard Einfeld Productions. And that was his name, Richard Einfeld. Very, really lovely guy. And so I started out transferring dailies. And after a while, he put me on to organizing the sound library and the sound effects library, all of that stuff, music library. And then he said, you know, I was interested in cutting because I'd go in and watch him cut. And he said, you know, if you want to clean up my cutting room, I'll show you how to do it, which meant assisting him. So he said, you roll up the trims like this, and you put them in the boxes they belong in, and put them up on the shelf, and You know, if I need something and you're standing behind me, you just get it. All the film goes in this bin. All the film that I'm asking for goes in here, and all the trim bins I'm putting over here. Then you can reconstitute them back, put them back on the shelf. Oh, wow, this looks great. So I was sitting in there with him. I learned almost everything from Richard just watching him. And that's the sad thing about digital editing, is that the assistant is not in the room with you. So they can't learn by absorption.
But Carol, also, when you were, so Carol was doing a, it was called the Women's Workshop AFI.
Uh-huh.
But you were also delivering dailies to Hal
Richards.
Ashby.
Yeah, I was working at Richards, and Hal Ashby wanted Richard to do his daily transfers because they were very, very high quality. And we really monitored them very, very closely. So we would transfer the dailies, and I would, not every day, but most days, I would deliver them over to Hal Ashby's cutting room. And then when they were through shooting, I would then deliver the things that he wanted, extra music, effects, you know, all kinds of things, reprints. I'd deliver them. And I would just sort of hang out at Al's, watch Hal work for a little bit. He'd say, he was a very sweet guy, Carol, come sit here. Just, do you have a minute? Why don't you watch us? So I watched Hal and his editors, primarily Bobby Jones, who's a fabulous editor, watch them work together, which was
But
amazing.
You were also, when you started doing film,
yeah,
he gave you advice.
Right. When I was working at Richards, I asked Richard if I could use his, well, he said, if you get a film to cut, either through the AFI or USC or UCLA, just cut it here, use my equipment. So that gave me, I had the football so I could play in the game.
Can you say what he told you about performance?
Which one?
Hal Ashby about.
Oh, yeah. Hal was always saying, if the actor's doing the work, the editor doesn't have to do it. Just let it play. Just let it play.
That is a big deal in editing.
Yeah,
trust the performance. Or trust the shot.
Yeah, trust the shot.
If it's working
in the shot and everything's there, don't cut. Don't be so impatient.
It takes courage to do that, too.
It really does. Yeah.
Not to cut.
So during this time that I was working for Richard, this is a long-winded answer to your question, he let me do all these different things. So I got a tiny taste of all these skill sets. And so I just worked on it. At one point, he said, there's a documentary on the shelf. They owe me money, so I won't give them the negative or the print. So if you want to cut it, I'm not going to cut it. But if you want to do it, do it. So I did, and he sold the documentary. So when the Women's Directors Workshop was founded at the AFI, I got the opportunity to do one with a woman director. His name is Karen Arthur. I did several projects with her, but that the first one was really set the bar really high. And she was fabulous, a wonderful director for visualization of a scene. And we did that, then I did a second one with her, and then Lee Grant was getting ready to do her project, and she was just finishing Shampoo with Hal Ashby. That's how she knew me and asked me to cut her film. So when we were cutting Lee's film, we would take it to Hal, and he would give us a critique as if he were the director or master editor, which he was, on the film. So I got this incredible feedback really early on when I was working from an editor who became a director. Hal was first a director and then he became an editor.
And even though he died young and his body of work is small,
it's all impeccable.
Literally every film.
Every
if you
film
look
is
up
unusual.
Every single
yeah,
one.
Being there, coming home.
Harold and Maude.
I mean, so many of my favorite films
Last Detail.
Right. Uh-huh.
And Shampoo,
and then the Woody Guthrie one, Bound for Glory, which is a fabulous film, wonderful
but
film.
Every single film, being there is
just really, really good. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh. What do you think are the best things coming out? What do you think the best things coming out of editing right now are, and what are the worst things?
Well, that's things.
Yeah. Best and worst phenomenon.
Well, this is my personal take, but I really am tired of seeing people pick up cameras and just follow an actor around and hoping that's going to be shaky cam, mm-hmm. this kind of stuff. Yeah. You know, you walk over here and I'll just follow you, and then maybe and you'll say your lines and you'll also ad lib while you're at it. I'm so sick of films that are primarily ad libs, because you could just smell it, you know. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't have any strength. Nor does this kind of following, you know, somebody around hoping there's some, you know.
It's really hard for the editor, because then the expectations are so unrealistic, you know.
Yeah, it's like, who's okay. directing this? Me in the cutting room? So I think that's kind of the worst stuff. Everything becomes reality TV, you know, mm-hmm. right away. Yep. And the ad-libbing, just, there's no strength in a decision, in giving an actor a sketch and saying, okay, do it. Oh, let's just do it again. Okay, let's just do it again. With different dialogue each time, they're in a different place each time. There's really nothing to anchor the scene to. So that kind of filmmaking just drives me nuts. I mean, people seem to think they're Cassavetes. Well, Cassavetes really knew what he was doing. And there may have been ad-libs, but he knew.
Within a framework.
Yeah, within a framework and architecture. And he was pretty strict about it, too. So that makes me crazy when people say, well, I just want to be like Cassavetes. So that really just drives me nuts. Now, there's a classic film this last year that I found to be absolutely extraordinary, Hell or High Water, my favorite film. Now, that has all the hallmarks of what I consider to be a terrific film. Beautiful visualization, great performances. It's a double buddy film. Not only is it, it's four buddies, two buddy teams. It is set in the West Texas. It has an incredible sense of place, totally believable. All the acting is good, even the waitress who covers for them when they have a botched bank robbery. The performances are fab. All of the main four performances are wonderful.
And it takes you to a place you don't expect to
go. You don't expect at all. You're starting to watch one film, and it slowly evolves into something completely different. It's the best of all of the post 2008 post crash films about, in a sense, about, you know, the malfeasance of banks and loaning people money and trying to, you know, essentially cheat people. And it's, it's the best of those films that have that theme. I just think it's brilliant.
Yeah.
And it's controlled.
And what's so interesting is the director, writer, the editor, the cinematographer, and the director, not the writer, are Scottish.
So they brought a fresh point of view to the film and a certain classicism that is expected of one in Europe, sorry to say, to an American film. It reminds me of Hud, which is one of my favorite films, which I think was, what was that, Marty Ritt in 63 or something?
That's a Paul Newman film, right?
Yeah, where he plays a total cad, you know. And it's fantastic, with Patricia O'Neill and Brandon DeWild, and it's a terrific cast. Wonderful film. So if you want to look at some tremendous editing in Hud and then look at Hell or High Water, you'll have a great pair of movies that are separated by about 50 years. Totally classic, fabulous, beautifully edited, incredibly, incredible emotional impact. And both films start out where you least they're going to go someplace where you least expect it.
Which is another big marker of a good film, is you should never be predictable.
Yeah, it evolves within the context. Yeah.
Hi. I'm curious what you think when you look at the TV that's so prominent today, because it really is kind of a new phenomenon, these big budget things that are sort of like faux movies without an endpoint, like, you know, all of the obvious TV shows that have been so huge. For example, like Deadwood, in a way, it's kind of like McCabe and Mrs. Miller stretched out
over
into an infinite.
Well,
that kind of runs.
Yeah.
I just wonder, when you look at that, does it seem kind of like cheating in a way, because you're just making this stream that's just going to go on indefinitely, and it doesn't have that nice container like a feature film does? or does each episode become kind of a little sub feature film? It just seems like such a weird new set of rules in a way for doing a narrative.
Well, if I were thinking of literature, I would say it's the difference between a finely honed novel and a saga of, in, you know, four volumes that has, you know. While they're extremely interesting, it's not the same experience at all. I don't compare them really, because they're really very, very different. Let's say all of the hero films, all the films with extravagant budgets have migrated to the big screen, and all the movies that frankly used to be my staple kind of film have migrated to the small screen. So those, I guess you would say, films about the human experience as we experience it are now on a much more intimate screen. So it calls for a different kind of storytelling. If we're working on a feature, we expect the audience to be there uninterrupted, and so we deal a great deal with pace and when things occur, you know, the sort of the unfolding of the story, uninterrupted. And it's in a very tight frame of, let's say, under 2 hours, or, you know, there's a framework. When you're looking at these films that continue over three and four years, you're watching sort of a saga unfold. The expectation is totally different. And you can really get inside of a character and in tangential stories that you could never tolerate in film. You can go off on a tangent and then come back. It's like a very well-written soap, in the sense that you have a cast of quite a few characters, and they sort of weave around, and you eventually, you know, you can stay with one character for one night, and the story weaves over into another character for another night. There's a side story here and a side story there.
And you also have different directors and editors,
yeah,
too.
Uh-huh.
Does it drive you a little crazy sometimes watching it when they're just almost seem to be just making?
Well, I think the expectation is different, but there it, I would have to say there's an awful lot of bloat. Mm-hmm. There's an awful lot of bloated stories.
Yeah. Like, why do we need to know what this character?
Except that they're contained in that one evening, and it's always under an hour, so, you know, it's not as though we're wearing people out. And attention spans are a hell of a lot shorter now. Mm-hmm. So maybe an hour is about all anybody can tolerate. I don't know how to answer the question. I think it's really, you know, oranges and apples, you know, kind of comparison.
You both have expressed to us how important it is to kind of incorporate other elements of living into your life to be a better artist. Are there certain things that you read to kind of stay sharp, or subjects that you study, or things that you've kind of absorbed to kind of inform your art in a way?
Well, I see a lot of movies, which is kind of the busman's holiday. And not only do you work on movies all day, but then you look at them at night.
You're also, because Carol's on the Board of Governors and involved with the Academy, she sees all the documentaries and all the
I see all the genres. I just love, I think right now, it's the golden age of documentaries. I'm just absolutely fascinated with them. And I just love to watch them. I love, for instance, I'm Not Your Negro. I thought that was just beautifully done, really a great documentary. It excites me to see films like that. I also love, I'm on the committee for selecting the foreign films. So I saw, I don't know, 35, 38 foreign films last year out of the 85 that were available to see. And I thought I was seeing a lot. But there were some extraordinary foreign films that were completely unlike anything I've ever seen. And I mean it. Just really great stuff. It just gives you a lot of good ideas, you know. There's so many ways to tell a story. I mean, we've barely tapped into it, you know. So that's exciting. And then just for my personal life, I love in-between movies because we spend so much time in a dark room, out of the sun and all of that. I like to take walking trips, and I go out in the desert or go up in the mountains. I live in L.A. So
how long was that trip you took? One time you took a 6 week.
Oh, it was a five-week trip across...
5 weeks of walking.
Walking across Spain. That was a big break. Then I've had a long hiking trip in Ireland, and two of them in France, and one across Spain, one in England. several in the States. I've done big parts of the Pacific Crest Trail because it's in California and it's really exciting. It's really wild. It's beautiful. And that just sort of cleanses you of, now I love it because you don't have a phone, you don't have anything. You're out there with your compass and a map, you know. So it's really exciting. So I like to vary it, do different things. Yeah.
To extend that, mm-hmm. it feels like, because I have a problem with balancing work
uh-huh.
and my personal life,
yeah.
and also just relaxing. I hardly know how to relax, but it seems like you have marathon, though. It sounds like marathon. You have a marathon feature, you have a marathon project you work on, and then you do a marathon walk.
That's part of it. That's part of, you know, I
She's
guess you say the
intense.
Addiction. You know, I have, you know, I probably would be addicted to something if I weren't addicted to films. And but you know, I get really focused, and then I don't know when to quit.
Yep.
That's just kind of the personality. For instance, I have a garden at home, and Dan knows all about this.
Yep.
I'm a fanatic about cactus and succulents, so I just have a whole huge yard full of them. And I don't know when to stop, you know. I'll go out and I'll say, oh, I'm just going to piddle around for like an hour, and I'm there for 3 or 4 hours.
But I think it's, you can embrace your obsessiveness as an editor. I mean, editors are a little, I mean.
We're a little obsessive.
It's okay.
Maybe it's a good personality trait.
I think it's okay.
For this, yeah.
I think it's fine.
Oh, I'm not condemning it.
I think it's also being
but
in
balance
New York.
But balance is a big
Being
role.
In New York is even more challenging,
yeah.
you know.
Oh, but you know, what I love about New York editors, really, is that there's so many things to do here. It's not the only business in town, so
yeah.
to speak.
Yeah.
There's so
Absolutely.
Many things, and I feel that editors who are New York editors, and I would say this even to my LA friends, are far more informed with theater, museums, shows, expositions, different kinds of film.
But you also
you know,
have friends outside the business.
Yes,
in
that's
LA,
why.
It's like an industry town. That's all people talk about. I mean, there is a difference between getting Variety delivered to your door and New York Times. You know what I mean?
But we have our iPads now.
But
yeah.
but anyway, that's but
the grass is always greener though, right? Because I go to LA and I see more culture than I do in New York half the time. Probably because in New York I'm in a dark room.
Yeah, right. But maybe you should liberate yourself here a little more.
Yeah,
just a little liberation in New York might be kind
of
nice.
Part of me mm-hmm. is just thinking about just taking the trip out west.
Well, hey.
Well, there's always that's the constant.
That's always great. I mean, you can. Here I am wearing snow boots. I never wear these in LA.
No, there's definitely, I mean, I spent half my life in both places.
That's right.
I'm originally in California,
uh-huh.
and I can definitely see the pluses.
Uh-huh.
But I also feel because it's a smaller business here, maybe I'm just imagining it, but it seems like it's a little more supportive
more,
as a
more
community. It's more intimate.
Uh-huh.
I
think so.
Yeah.
People really know each other here. It's a nice
but
feeling.
There's something
uh-huh.
to be said for that.
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah. Whoever. Yeah, okay. Go.
You told the story about when you had to arbitrate an editor credit
mm-hmm.
and you had the same footage of a film cut by two different editors
mm-hmm.
and two,
mm-hmm.
two very high-level editors.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to know, what were some of the things that you saw and the differences between them? Was the pacing shorter? Were scenes going on too long?
Everything was different. Everything was different. The choices were unbelievably different. One of them was sort of a straight ahead. This was a thriller. And the most important thing was that we as the audience were ahead of the actor, the main actor, whose point of view it was. And for a thriller, you don't want to be there. You want to, you know, you don't want the audience to be ahead of the protagonist. You want the protagonist to be constantly finding out things that the, you know, for the most part, obviously there are wonderful differences in films sometimes, and you can also make a jarring change in the middle of a film where you change point of view. But in this particular film, it was clearly night and day. And I felt that I was in good hands all the way through the movie. There was none of this sort of wobbly stuff.
Which did you see first?
I saw the one that the first editor did, and then I saw the one that Jerry did. Uh-huh. And this was back in the film days. I thought you were going to ask me, how did we get two prints? We made a color dupe of the first editor's effort, which had a temp mix on it, so it wasn't just a dialogue track. And then we saw Jerry's at the same point. We did not see a finished film. We did. They were both at the same point. Mm-hmm. Yes, back there.
To stay in the same lane of like self-care, mm-hmm. you mentioned that you eat a light lunch, and I'm assuming you do that to kind of stay alert. You know,
yeah, yeah.
Sleep, mm-hmm. like that. What other things do you do to kind of maintain like alertness throughout the day? You mentioned like going out for a walk.
Yeah. Well, I've grown accustomed to a bench that I can raise, so I usually stand all morning. Then after lunch, I may sit down for the afternoon, or I may start standing, and then towards the end of the day, I get a little tired because I'm an old woman. I'll sit for a little bit. But I find that it really keeps you alert if you're standing. You're not going to nod off if you're standing. All over. And I, during the day, I don't ever eat snacks in the cutting room. I keep all the snacks out of there. I don't eat anything in the cutting room, but I sip tea or water all day just to stay hydrated. I've found that that really keeps you mentally alert. I don't drink that much coffee during the day. I'll have a cup in the morning. I'm just telling you what I do. I mean, I'm sure this is really interesting. But
they just want to be you. They're
trying. But no, I really try to stay away from the junk, the candy, the, you know, the crackers and bagels and all that stuff. Just, you know, I have a good breakfast, have a light lunch, and it keeps me alert. If I need to, I'll go take a walk. I love to take a break. I'll take a break every hour or so just to look up, rest my eyes, wander around the hall maybe.
You think a lot of editors are morning people? You're a morning person.
I'm definitely a morning person.
Same
yeah.
with uh-huh. too.
Yeah.
But I guess you have to know what your peak times are. Yeah,
because that's when you
want to
work.
And then make the most of mm-hmm. it. Yeah.
yeah. I go in and I do, that's why I want to do the things that really, that I really need to remember, like dailies. I'll look at that first in the morning. And, you know. But I really try to get a good night's sleep. I think it's so important. Sleep deprivation will mess you up. So I don't pull all-nighters anymore.
Do you dream about your cuts?
No. 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 My dreams are very different. I'm in a different movie in my dreams. No, but I think for me, I need a good night's sleep, you know, let's say 7 hours. 6-7 hours. Any less than that, I'm no good. And learning how to relax at night's really important, you know, kind of divorce yourself from what you've done that day and don't worry about it. However you do it, I'm sure everybody has their way of doing that. I think it's really important. I know, yes.
I believe you touched upon the point that as a creative person, it's very rewarding for you to be the one who puts the final product together.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. To come alive. But on the reverse side of it, how do you deal personally, emotionally, about the fact that you're really only as good as somebody, what comes out of your hands is limited by somebody else's vision and execution,
mm-hmm.
by what is brought into the editor?
Mm-hmm.
How do you personally deal with not necessarily being able
to do the best? Well, that's the trade-off always. I would answer that question by saying that I, from very early on, I was talking about this lady at the Ladies Directors Workshop at the AFI, Women's Directors Workshop. Even from that point forward, I realized that working on something of quality, even if it's less money, but a story that I can actually believe in myself, that's the difference. And I have stayed away from things that I know I can't cut. I just can't do them. I don't want to do them. These big bloody things that have, you know, a body count of 250, 300, 1,000,000. I just can't do those. So I've always stayed away from that. So right away, I like to work on things that I know that I have some emotional rapport with. And I've stayed away from the things that my gut tells me don't do it. And a couple of times that I have done those films because I got talked into them have been a disaster. Now, maybe my gut was telling me that, you know, what I was going to work with wasn't all that great, but I saw it as essentially films that I really had no affinity with. I think that's number one. And if you're able to, if you're lucky enough to make choices on films that you have an affinity with, or with a director with, you know, with whom you have incredible sense of integrity, you know, that person does, you're already ahead of the game. There are times when I have the potential of the film was so compromised by the direction that I worked 20 times harder on that than on other films. They are the ones that are really hard to do. They're really, really hard to do. So just make choices. Be very careful with the choices you make. Because yes, you're absolutely right. We are compromised by the material that's given to us.
I was just wondering if you could share another anecdote like you did with the previous one about the big...
The Big Chill?
The Big Chill, but mm-hmm. maybe another film that most of people have seen, like E.T. or a Manchurian Candidate, where, you know, like you brought something
mm-hmm.
That kind of like really changed how the film developed.
Well, I guess I could, you know, there are lots of instances. Let me think of something for a moment that would, you know, that would work for this. I'm a blank.
Well, I mean, what about when you were talking about it on E.T., just the challenge?
Oh, the challenge of the puppet?
Yeah.
Every time that, well, a magazine of film is like 10 minutes long. So every time that the puppet in E.T., first of all, there were several parts of E.T. There was E.T. who was in a complete suit, a small person in a E.T. rubber suit that weighed 40 pounds, almost as much as the person weighed who was wearing it. Then there were little people who were taller than that, who were wearing full costumes, and they were too tall, so they were always walking in a trench to make them shorter. Then the actual puppet itself was just from about just below the waist up, and the only thing that articulated was the head, the eyes, blinking of the eyes, and the neck up and down. The shoulders were pretty much immobile. So you're dealing with an animated head, really. So the arms never that were attached to the puppet never really worked that well. So the gestures were a mime artist whose arms came out through here. Like the top of a table, E.T. would be like this, and you'd see the hands reach out over the top of the table. That was a mime artist. So we were marrying all these different objects to create one believable E.T., one extraterrestrial. And I remember we had, Stephen and I had a long conversation about if we can make the character believable, the film will work. So we spent almost all of our time getting the puppet to work in each scene. What can we do to make it seem like it's real? Luckily, we didn't, well, in a way, we didn't have digital. We didn't have CGI. That's all you could do. You either had a model or you didn't do it. So the kids, the children, were relating to a real object. That's the difference between a CGI character that's, you know, green screened in and a model. A model is really in space, right in front of the kids, so they could act to that model even if the model really wasn't doing much or just sitting there. So that was our big, big challenge. And a lot of the scenes that we really felt we needed didn't work because it was we either had too much of a view of E.T. or E.T. didn't really work as a real character. So we were constantly working on E.T. and then fitting the story around it. You know, what's really going to work? When, at one point, Stephen wanted to go back in, this is like 25 years later, sorry, this is not recent. wanted to go back in and use CGI for a lot of the things that we felt didn't work that well. Went back in, did all of them, and he said, none of it works. So he didn't use them, any of it. The only thing he used was changing the pistol to a phone because he really didn't like the fact that little kids were being surrounded by firearms. He said it was a big mistake. So, but the other things that he tried, CGI, just didn't work. Even the model against the sky, the model flying up, you know, when E.T. takes off, when, you know, through mental telepathy, he makes the bike leave the street and go up in the, you know, to evade the cops. We just stayed with the models. They worked, you know. So that, I think that's, was really interesting how much effort we put in into creating the little guy. Because when we were working, all we heard was Steven just screaming over everything. The pneumatic tubes were so loud, it was like having a locomotive in the room. Well, that's an exaggeration. But they were very, very loud. So we knew we were going to have to replace all that sound. So he was just screaming and yelling and carrying on all the way through it. So we had a temporary voice, and then it was then Ben Burt at ILM was the main sound editor for E.T., for his voice, for his body movements and all that. And he created the creature's voice. Which
he
we then
a lot of Pixar films too.
Yeah, he's really, really talented.
He's really great.
And Chuck Campbell, who was a sound effects editor, whom we would call a sound designer now, was responsible for the rest of the, you know, the sound was all the atmosphere and all of that was really, really important.
And it was mm-hmm. a very secretive.
It was very
oh
secretive.
My God.
Oh yeah, it was held under wraps. Absolutely.
What did he? What was the thing with the reels? Or
oh, we did it. We did a temp dub. To be able to show the film, and he didn't want anybody to see the character of E.T., so he told me to go through the film and put in leader, meaning blank, where there was E.T., so I had to explain to the mixers what was that. It was like mixing a radio show every time we got to E.T., because he didn't want anybody to see that for fear that they, you know, it takes a long time for a movie to come out, for fear that someone in some sort of cheap version would get a movie out ahead of him that would have an extraterrestrial in it. So, and all the special effects, like the spaceship taking off and all of that, I had to animate it on a piece of film that we just put in there, and it just says spaceship takes off, spaceship midway, spaceship ends, spaceship out of frame. Just writing it so it'd go, it's wacky. But so I was explaining to the mixers, the re-recording mixers, what it was we were doing.
Oh my goodness, that's amazing.
Going blind. Back there, yeah.
What advice could you share in terms of assistants trying to become editors, or even persons trying to get into post-production to become assistant editors? Like what advice can you share in terms of moving up or even getting in and sort of?
Well, in getting in, that's, you know, I don't really know where the entry-level jobs are these days, so it's hard for me to say, but I would say get an entry-level job where you can sort of observe the process, even if you're answering phones or, you know, you're delivering coffee or whatever it is, making coffee or doing, you know, any kind of odd job. So that you're around filmmakers and people who are making, you hear the language, you hear people critiquing things, you just kind of learn by absorption. That's always a good way to do it. Another way, I think, is to really learn film language by looking at lots and lots of movies. And I mean, when you're looking at movies, look at them like an editor. Just isolate certain, and this may sound really ridiculous, but I think it's a good thing to do. In a movie, because now you can look at it digitally and go back and forth. When I was learning, you either saw a film in real time or you didn't see it. It was in the theater then and it was gone. You know, so you had to look at it. I'd go see them two or three times. So you want to just see how characters are introduced. You want to see how people move from place to place. For instance, I mean, just something really stupid like going through doors, getting in and out of cars. How action is jumped, and it's believable when it's jumped, how when you thread someone through moment to moment to moment from one place to the next, all these things that I would call either montage or mise-en-scène type editing, see how it's done by other people, and just have a catalog of all that in your head.
Transitions.
Yeah, transitions. Simple transitions that get, you know, say from a close-up to a long shot in one spot and to another. Just learn the film language of how an editor uses all these tools in a film. I think one to really study well is a film that was edited by a friend of mine, Joe Walker. It's called Sicario, which was like two or three years ago.
No.
Very, very, very well edited, extremely well edited. Another one, also by a friend who's a New Yorker, Chris Tellefson, did a film called Capote. It has one of the most brilliant opening scenes I've seen in practically any movie. It's just really, really well
movie,
done.
The whole movie. How about the hanging scene?
Yeah, the whole movie is just wonderful. And it's essentially a biopic about Truman Capote. But it's also about, you know, the murder and all that. So it's very, very rich, dramatic material.
Why it handled works. Why is this working?
Yeah, it's just really, really good. And it's surprising, you know, the way that the material is handled editorially. So does that help you a little bit?
Mm-hmm. But can I also say,
sure.
Whenever I do events with editors and they talk about their path to success, there's one common theme, or a common thing I notice, is that they all work their asses off. You know, like, any chance they got to edit a sequence, you know, even, or just anything, just get their hands on it and do it, and work really hard, and be someone that someone wants to hang out with. Be a nice person. You never know who's going to help you. And it's better to be a nice person anyway, right? But because it's such, you know, it's so fraught, the business is so fraught with egos and pressure and stress, that you want to, you know, if you have two people that are equally talented and one is someone you want to hang out with, you're going to hire that person. And your reputation will follow you. But you know, the odds of making it are so, can be so overwhelming sometimes. You go, oh, am I ever going to get a break? But what you're doing by being a hard worker and being someone that someone likes to be around is you're just increasing your odds. So then if you it is luck and timing, but you're just increasing your odds that luck and timing will hit you because of all the things you're doing all the time.
That's right.
And then that moment comes.
That's right.
Because you're doing them. You know what I mean? So it does, and every story is they work really hard, passionate, you know, just all that stuff. It's never a story where, I was just sitting around, it just fell into my lap, and I became an editor.
Funny thing, didn't work that way. you sort of have to pay your dues in the sense of, you know, like I was mentioning when I was working at this little sound house, I cut everything that came in my path, you know, I mean, literally, just anything I could get my hands on, even if it was sound effects and music, I just went for it.
That's always mm-hmm. the stories.
I did anything that came my way, you know, documentaries, commercials, corporate films, you know, teaching films. I did two or three crazy little animated films that were just kind of wacky, but they were fun. I recorded effects. I went out with a Niagara.
So you're getting the experience, but you're
just
also, people will notice that. They'll see someone who's doing.
You just game for anything, That was a good question. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Kind of keeping in that theme, is there any particular collaboration that you really enjoyed, or any film that you didn't mention that you really enjoyed working on?
Films that I've been, I've kind of enjoyed all of them. I've been really lucky. I've sort of enjoyed all of them. There were two experiences that were not good, but that's not bad out of 35, 37 films.
That's good odds.
Mm-hmm.
But you were also.
Oh, and I do want to talk about one thing, because this really, I think this is really, really important. What if someone asked me to replace an editor? Bad situation. This is how I handle it. Many times, editors are just like a marriage. They just don't work out. But what I don't want to do is arrive in an editing room where neither the producer nor the director had the gumption to tell the editor that they were going to be replaced, and I just arrive, or any editor just arrives as the replacement. That's not good. I have done doctor jobs. I have done jobs where I've been this editor who has replaced someone, and I won't do that unless I tell the director, I won't do it unless you will let me call the editor after you've told him that you want to replace him and ask him if it's okay. Are you all right with that? And if he says, absolutely not, I won't do it.
She has a lot of integrity. I don't know if everybody would do that.
But I think what you have to do is you have to at least make certain that there are no surprises, that that person has been informed, that at least that another person, you owe that to someone who has worked so hard on a movie, who is going to be replaced, that you're not happy for a reason. The director needs to be a mensch and step forward and say, you know, it's just not working out.
And it's especially mm-hmm. common because of digital, because you can just do another
do all kinds of crazy things
without the editor yeah. even knowing. That can happen.
Yeah, that can happen too. So I just feel that you have to be absolutely honest. And for myself, I won't go on a movie unless I've talked to that person. And I will encourage that person to stay on if they want to. You know, I mean, it's only fair. You invest so much into it, and you're shattered when someone says,
a lot of times you're just the mm-hmm. fall guy anyway.
Yeah.
It's not even
And something else that I've realized, that a director, according to the guild rules, the DGA, is supposed to have 10 weeks for their cut. Producers want to see it before then. And I always encourage a director to use the full time. If you have 10 weeks, use it. Don't show anybody. They'll only be able to see it once. A lot of times a director, and this has happened a lot, will want to have more than the 10 weeks. They'll show the film and say, I need to replace the editor so he can get more time. It's a horrible strategy, but that is happening.
How about when you get stuck between the producer comes to you and says, don't tell the editor, but I want to do this.
Oh, you mean the producer coming to me saying, don't tell the director, we want you to do this?
Just starting the sentence, don't tell the director. But
I can't do that.
It's really important to align yourself with your director, is with
the director.
But every editor should.
I interpret the film for the director.
And you're their advocate.
Absolutely. I am loyal to the director. And all of our arguments will be between us.
And that can happen.
The political situation, especially with digital now. And especially in long-term television, where the boss is the producer. The showrunner, the producer, not the director changes every time you do something. So I'm talking about feature films. You just have to know who the person in power is and know that for myself, it's the director where my allegiance lies. And but like I said, I'm an old-time film director, film editor, so I still work like a film editor.
I mean, you could mm-hmm. still, but just not keeping secrets. I mean, it's
No. You don't ever want to go behind anybody's back and have another version, or, you know, we'll show him something brilliant and then, you know, no, you don't want to do that.
Do we have any?
Any more questions?
I think we should continue asking questions.
Out there? Okay.
And this has been incredibly inspiring. I'm sure everybody agrees. So,
well, thank you, guys. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.